The today discussion we will discuss about the idealism, wherein we will see that what is idealism, what are the basic belief of the idealistic philosophy, who belongs to the idealistic philosophy, what are the basic feature of idealism, and at last we will see what are the some of the type of idealism. This thing we will use to discuss in this class. So before starting the idealism, there are certain things that we will see. The one thing is that what is materialism and what is spiritualism? What is spiritualistic thing and what is the materials? These two things we will first discuss, because in this contrast the school of philosophy of idealism emerges. The first thing is that materialism. Materialistic thought believes that world is a kind of a machines wherein we used to come to perform certain work, and the materials, the money, the power, the machines, the industry, these governs the world. So it is not the other thing, rather than the materials are governing the world. That is the basic of the materialistic thought. In contrast with the materialistic thought, there is another thought, which is the spiritualism. Spiritualism says that material is not important, because materials are the mortal. Even the material, when we talk, so our body is also material, a kind of a thing. Everything is a material, and these are the mortal. Material spiritualistic philosophy emerge in contrast with that which is immortal, which is not a mortal, because mortal thing will end, they will complete their life cycle and they will end. But the spiritualistic thing, like our mind, like our thought, like our ideas, they are not a mortal. They are immortal. They will never end. They will not die. They will not end after completing their cycle. So these are the immortal thing. Even the concept of a God. God is not a mortal. God is an immortal. It will never end. They will not end after completing their cycles. But materialistic thing, they can end when they will end their life cycle. So idealism emerges in contrast with these two. So I was talking that in this contrast the idealistic philosophy emerges. So idealism is a shift that emphasizes from the natural or a scientific fact of a life to the spiritual aspect of a human life, the human experiences, the mind, the thought. So it emerges in this context. This idealism assumes that the knowledge acquired through the activity, creativity, and the exercise of a mind is the important knowledge, not the knowledge, that kind of a thing which we acquire through the senses. Because why? Because we will see that senses, sensory organs, are the also important factor when we think of acquiring knowledge. But the idealistic philosophy says that the senses are contextual in nature. That may not be a reality. So the different type of a school, different school of philosophy, when we will see, they will be focused on defining the axiology, metaphysics, epistemology in a different perspective. The perspective that idealism adapts, that the kind of a knowledge that we acquire by exercising the mental power, by thinking about something, by bringing the creativity in the something, by doing some activity, that are the real knowledge. That is the, you can understand that this is the epistemology, how the knowledge is structured in this philosophy. Okay, so that is the real. That kind of a knowledge that we are getting through our senses is not a real, because these are the contextual in nature. And those who are a contextual in nature, that cannot be a real. That is true in that context, not a universally true. And that's why if this is a true in a particular context, that's why it is a mortal. Means when the context will be not there, then the knowledge will also not exist. So those knowledge are not a real knowledge. The real knowledge is what? Which is coming out of our thought process, which is coming out of our mental exercise. That are the real knowledge. Even the idealism recognize the idea, feeling, and are the more important thing, the material object. So our ideas and a feeling and a emotion gets a primacy over the material objects. And from this discussion, we can find that the moral values, the ethical values, the spiritual values, they got a primacy in the human life, because the morality, it is not a mortal. However, the further discussion, you can say that morality is also a contextual, because whatever the morality or whatever the code of conduct of a moral is true in our society may not be true in the other society, or whatever which is not permissible there may be permissible in our society, and vice versa. But anyway, the morality here in the idealism is linked with the ethical practices. What is ethical? And when we talk about the ethics, it is not a mortal. It is an absolute. And that's why the idealism says that the morality, ethical practices, and the spiritual value, these gets the primacy over the material world. And one more thing is that which is misunderstood, like that here when we are talking the spiritualism. Spiritualism is not directly linked to the religion. It may be linked in the some context. But spiritualism talks from the ethical point of view, not the religious doctrine point of view. When we talk about the religion, religion talks the things, religion explains the things, even the morality, religion explains from their religious doctrine point of view. For Hinduism, it may be Vedas, Upanishads. For Muslims, it may be the Quran. For Christians, it may be the Bible. Or for the Sikh, it may be Guru Granth Sahib, like that. So that is the problem with the religion. that they used to see from that perspective. And that's why the further then you will see the theology comes, which is the study of a religious doctrine and its explanation. Theology. But when we talk about the spiritual perspective, it is not from the religious point of view. It is from the morality and it is from the ethical point of view, which is right for the society, which is right for the mankind, which is right for the betterment of everyone, even the human and non-human. When we talk about the animals, when we talk about the plant, spirituality talks about the betterment of all those things, not only the betterment of humans. Okay, so this is the brief of the idealism. It is emphasizing the spiritual world, which is not a mortal, and it rejects the materialistic world. Isn't it? This is when we talk about the philosophers, those who are belonging from this idealism, there are a lot from the Indian to the Western. Like from the Indian, when we talk, the Vivekananda, Dayanand Saraswati, Tagore, even Mahatma Gandhi, Aurobindo, they belongs from this school of a philosophy. Even when you will talk about the Aurobindo and Gandhi, their philosophical thought also belongs from the other philosophical act, like the naturalism. They also belong, because this is the pure school of a philosophy. And when we talk about the Mahatma Gandhi and the Aurobindo and the Vivekananda and all those things, they have their own philosophy of a life, and they have been influenced with the some other school of a philosophy also. Like that, when I am going through the different school of a philosophy, I am analyzing and I am making my own thought. So my philosophy will reflect the essence of a different philosophical schools. But this idealism is the prime focus of their philosophy. That's why we used to say that they belong from the idealism. Even when we talk about the Western philosophy, like that, the Hegel, Plato, Socrates, they belong from the idealism. Isn't it? Then when we talk about the origin of the idealism, the first we will see that the origin of a word idealism. Or when we see the idealism, the idea, idean plus ism, these are the two components of the word idealism, which means that something which are figuratively important. Figuratively important means they have their own importance and they are not depending upon the others. And some also believe that the philosophy of idealism has been emerged out of the Plato theory, the theory of ideas. It is given by the Plato. And they say that from there, this word emerges, this school of philosophy emerges. However, when we see the conception of a philosophical school idealism, you will find that idealism was existing in some or other form well before the Plato also. But we find a link between the Plato philosophy and the theory of ideas of a philosophy of a Plato to the idealism. And in this theory of idea, Plato talks about the ultimate supremacy of idea. The idea is the ultimate reality, and that should get the ultimate supremacy. than the material world. So idea is important, your thought is important, and thought is the original, and it will not be mortal, it will be immortal, it will never die. Like that, when we talk about the Plato, you can see his example that the whatever the thought, whatever the ideas that was given up by the Plato are still significant in some or other ways, and they are still continuing. However, the mortal world of the Plato, their belongings, their own body is not existing now, but the idea is existing. So that's why it says that material world is not a real and they are mortal. So what is the real? What should get the supremacy? The thing which will be never a mortal. So that is the idea. Sometime I told that it is a very closely linked to the spiritualism, where in the it is defined from the ethics and a morality point of view, and that's why the sometime idealism is also termed as a spiritualism, which says that spiritual world is a more important than the material world, because the material world is a destructible and a mortal, whereas the spiritual world is a not destructible and it is a not a mortal. And the idealism believes that there is a nothing beyond the spiritual world and the spiritual world, because this is the only reality. It is the point of a reference that what you think and how you consider. For someone, that the material world may be very important, because they think that when they have got a birth on this earth, they should enjoy all the things available on the earth. So it is a perspective from where you are trying to see the life and a reality. They think that the spiritual world and the spiritual values are the real, and these are the ultimate reality, not the others. And that's why the feeling, ideas are the real thing. Reality of a mind, capacity of a mind and soul are the real. According to the idealistic philosophy, the values are immortal. And that's why humans are primarily spiritual in nature, not a materialistic in nature, because the humans are governed by their soul and their mind and their ideas. So that is the perspective. Then this says that the idealistic philosophy, the highest place is acquired by the human by studying the human minds, human personality. You can acquire the highest place when you will study the mind, because mind and ideas are the real, they are immortal. Even when we see the some of the philosopher, that they have one of the very prominent philosopher, that the Patrick, G.T.W. Patrick, in his opinion, the idealistic refuse to believe that world is a great machine. World is not made of the machines which are the mortal. No, world is not made by that. They deny that the supremacy of the matter, machines and the other form of energy. Rather than they think that the ideas, the belief are the real thing. The machines are not real. And that's why idealism is a philosophical position which believes and see that nothing exists except the idea in the mind of a man or the human. So in this world, nothing exists except the idea of a human, the original creativity of a human. So they believe. And ideas are not changeable. Otherwise, that materialistic world is changeable. Isn't it? So this, when we see that the idealism, you will find that here there is a supremacy of the idea and mind and creativity rather than which is a mortal materialistic world. And that's why the idealistic philosopher believes that human are created by some supreme force, and this force may be the God. So God is the creator of a human, and since the God is a creator of a human, so if it is a created, so it will die. But the idea, the thought, from exercising the mind power that will be generated will never die. That's why I say that the wisdom or a mental attitude is meant by attaining the knowledge of a truth. So that mental power that we are using, it is for knowing the truth. What is the truth? And the truth is the idea. They also say that there should be the supremacy of the eternal values, which are absolute. They also say that man is not a creation of an environment like the animals. Like that, those who are the atheists. Because before that we have seen there is a two thought. That one is the thought process, those who are the atheist and those who are the theist. Those who believe in the religious doctrine, they are the theist. And those who don't believe in the God and the religious doctrine, they are atheist. And atheist used to believe that there is no such kind of a God who have created us, rather than it is the environment, it is the nature who has created us. Like that, when we talk about the Charles Darwin, who is the one of the great scientists and a philosopher of the era, he was atheist in nature, and he has given a theory of origin, that the survival of a superior. Those who are superior in adapting the situation, they will only survive. And how the human has emerged from their ancestors, they has given a theory which believes that it is a condition, it is a nature who has created us. There is no such God. But these idealistic philosophers believes that there is nothing, a nature who has created us, rather than there is some supreme power who have created us, not a God. Like that, the atheist used to say that. But they used to say that the nature is not creating us. Nature is not deciding who will take the birth. It is the supreme power who is deciding and who is creating. And that's why when you will see the philosophy of Aurobindo or a Tagore or the Gandhi, you will find they have never denied the existence of a God. They have never denied. They were not atheist, they were theist. They were believing in the God. If you will not believe in the God, then you cannot be idealistic, because in the idealistic, they believe the supremacy of the ideas, supremacy of the mental exercise, and there is some supreme power who have created us in this world. They also say that the physical universe, like that the surroundings, like that the forest, like that the house, like that the relatives, like that the equipment of our comfort, like that the mobile phone and everything by which we are surrounded. These are not real, and that's why they are supposed to avoid. That's why when you will see the philosophy of a Gandhi or Aurobindo or a Rabindranath Tagore, they have never believed in those things, the equipment for our luxurious life. However, when we talk about the Tagore, he was idealistic with a naturalistic also. He was believing in the nature, that the nature is the place where our mental power can grow. The man and human can learn and grow in the nature. So वहाँ पे थोड़ा सा you can find there is a situation of a contrast in his philosophy. But in general, they will be not attracted towards the material world. Rather than for them, the spiritual world will be more important. Even they believe that spiritual values are eternal, absolute, and unchangeable. And more importantly, important thing is that as per them, the wisdom or intellectual enlightenment is a source of attaining true knowledge. So, how this wisdom and intellectual enlightenment will come, because this is the source of a true knowledge. This enlightenment and a wisdom, when you will see even the taxonomy of a learning, you will find that the wisdom is the highest level of attainment. Highest level. And that cannot be attained by everybody. Wisdom cannot be attained by everybody. So simply, you have to do so much of a mental exercise to bring your original idea in a practice to have a wisdom, to have a intellectual enlightenment. Intellectual enlightenment and a wisdom cannot be attained by everybody. It is not attained by everybody. You may be very knowledgeable, you may be understanding, you may have an analysis and a synthesis ability, you may have a skill, problem solving skill, and so much of a thing, but the wisdom is the highest in that hierarchy, which is not attainable by everybody. That's why we say that everybody is not getting the enlightenment. They are not liberated from this materialistic world. When you will get the enlightenment, you will be liberated from the materialistic world. That's why when we see just now we have studied about the Buddhism and the Jainism. They have attained the enlightenment. So this material world, what is surrounding to them, is no more important for them. Is not important now. So that is the highest level, and this is the only real truth. And that how it can be attained? By the mental exercise. So this is the more important. And another thing in the idealism is that when we talk about the ideas, when we talk about the creativity, the originality, these can be enhanced by fusion of the multiple ideas. If you are alone, if you are not sharing your ideas, your thought, your knowledge to others, and you are not getting the others' knowledge and a thought or ideas, then it will not grow. For growing the idea and a thought, it must be shared. And when it will be shared, then the fusion of ideas will happen. Because you will be able to see from a different perspective. And when you will see from the different perspective, then the idea will grow. And that's why the idealistic philosophers believes in the universal brotherhood. they believe in the unity, in the diversity, because their ideas are different. Diversity in the sense that every man is a unique. They have their own mental capability and they have their own thought process and unique idea. So there is a diversity in the ideas. See, every religion talks about the betterment of the world. Even when we see the Buddhism and Jainism, these two things we have already discussed. So they were talking about the betterment of the world and a society and a mankind. But the approach of attaining that was different. The way of seeing and perceiving is a different. So that sense, in that sense, there is a diversity. But when they will fuse, when they will be said and when they will be analyzed, then you can understand that which is the more suitable and more effective way to attain that. And that's why they are the firm believer of university in a diversity, the universal brotherhood, and that we must work collectively. And this feature, when you will see the idealistic philosopher, you will find them. And that's why the Tagore says the Biswabharti concept. Universal brotherhood was one of the essence in the Rabindranath Tagore's philosophy. Universal brotherhood. And that's why the institution he established is named as the Biswabharti. When you will see his philosophy, then you will find all those things. And the next thing in which the idealism believes that man, the human, needs to encouragement or light to face the darkness. Because the mental process and the ultimate reality cannot be achieved so easily. And that's by the continuous effort, continuous motivation and encouragement is required for them. So that is the another feature of a idealistic philosophy. Then we will see in a brief that different form of idealistic philosophy. There are different forms. The one form which is a exponent promoted by the Berkeley, which is known as the personalistic idealism, or it is also known as the subjective idealism. And in this personalistic idealism and the subjective idealism, that is a proponent by the Berkeley, he accepts that the only existence of a mind. So he says that the mind is the only ultimate reality and a truth. The other things like the attributes, quality and all those things are a mortal because they are subjective in nature. Like that earlier I was saying that even the thought, even the attributes, quality develops in a particular context. In the earlier classes also I was talking that in order to understand the different philosopher, their philosophical ideas, first we have to understand in which situation they have grown up, because that shapes their idea. And that's why Berkeley was in a position that not ideas and other things and the attributes and the quality is real. They are mortal because they are contextual in nature. What is the reality? Then the mind is a reality, which have a power and a capacity of a thinking. So that was the opinion of Berkeley, and that's why the sub-school of idealism based upon his thought is known as a personalistic or a subjective idealism. Then there is another school of within the idealism was proponent by Fichte and Hegel. and this is known as the absolute idealism. They consider, the absolute idealistic consider, that the only soul, self, is the absolute reality. The other thing is a part of a physical world, and that's why they are a mortal and they are not a real. They say that the soul is a immortal, and a soul has a capacity of taking the different shape and the different body, and the soul has a capacity of a thinking and a creating a new thing. That's why it is the soul which is the real, not the other thing. Other thing is a immortal. Sorry, other thing is a mortal. Only the soul is a immortal. So he says that in the physical world, all events are governed by some ones. It may be the nature, it may be the God, or someone is governing the other things. But it is the soul which is the self-governed. That's why it is a real. In contrast with, there was another sub-school in the idealistic philosophy, which was proponent by the Plato. And he says that in his opinion, the reality of spirit is not because of the realization by someone, but the independent of the realization. He says that whatever the objective and the realism and all those things we are saying, that is a not absolute reality. Absolute reality is the God. Because God is creating everything. So if the God is creating, then that is the absolute reality. Everything which is existing is created by the God. So if it is created, then it will be mortal. But God is not a mortal. God is not created by someone. So the God is the reality. So it is the process of defining what is the reality and what is the ideal. The essence of idealism is that the idea, the reality, which is not a mortal, that should get a supremacy. That should be a prime focus. There was another sub-school of a philosophy in the idealism that is known as the phenomenal idealism. And it is proponent by the Kant. He says that the original or absolute reality cannot be known. It is beyond the capacity of our mind. For example, he used to give, for example, like the God, like the heaven, like the hell, all those things. It is beyond the capacity of our mind. We cannot know the reality of all those things. How the God is, whatever the figure, picture, all those things we used to see, it is based upon the something, or it is sometimes it is based upon our creativity. But none of us have seen the God. You may say that I have experienced the existence of God, some used to say. So it is your experience which is contextual in nature, but we have never seen the God. So that's why they used to say that it is the beyond the capacity of the human mind to know the reality about the all those things. Okay. So all the things are mortal and those are not a real. The reality of a thing cannot be known. So whatever we have, all things are mortal and we don't know the reality about all those things. So that was the opinion of a Kant in the phenomenal idealism.